Hello, good afternoon. I am Olga Tischlingerová, and along with my colleagues Martin Matze and Jess van Rooyen, we welcome you to this webinar. Just a few housekeeping rules for the webinar. For the information, we are recording the webinar, and recording will be available later this week should you wish to listen back or show to your colleagues who perhaps were not able to join today. If you have a question, you can type it in a question box as everyone's microphone will be muted. After the presentation is finished, we will answer the questions. That's all from me. Jess, Martin, over to you now, please.
Yes, thank you very much, Olga. Okay, my name is Martin Matsen. Nowadays, I'm the Global Business Development Manager at Data Centers, within ATS. And before that, I was the founder and owner of Perf IT. And we used to be a DCM company, so we sold our DCM solution to around 200 data centers. Yes, sir?
Yeah, hi, good afternoon. My name is Jesse Van Rooyen. I am in the data center domain since 2010. I have served in a couple of different roles, from a DCIM consultant to project manager, and now I'm a project leader at ATS. Back to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. The agenda for today. First, I have some slides, about four or five slides about the company to give you a little bit more impression about who we are, what we are doing. And then we're going to have the following subjects. There was an uptime survey summer last year, and we will like to tell you something about that. And then we have some, based on that, we have some examples and some ideas how to improve your data center operation and management. So looking to the company, ATS Global. ATS Global is already there for 35 years, and we have around 1,100 people working for us in 29 countries. And if you look to the data center, we are active in domains cybersecurity, IoT, OT, and controls and robotics DCM. So we are a technical system integrator who have created our own DCM solution, but we also deliver third-party DCM solution implementations. So to give you some impression where we are, of course we are a manufacturing process control, but if you look to the data center part, like I said, we have around 200 plus customers, and we have some very nice names, I think, like Microsoft, AWS, Interxion, Digital Realty, Facebook. So we have some very nice names who are our customers. And looking to our office locations, like I said, we are at the moment active in 29 countries around the world, and we can deliver our software DCM solution from all those offices to all those countries and the countries around that. So looking to our DCM solution itself, it's a complete DCM suite. So it consists of the various modules like energy management, cooling management, building management. And of course, if you want to monitor and optimize your data center, you also need some control. And what makes us different compared to other suppliers like BMS, EMS vendors, we build all kinds of tools around it to make information more valuable. So we have some analytical tools for performance management, performance optimization, also capacity management with failover management, with a lot of checks and balances into it. So we can find human errors, we can find broken equipment, we can find a lot of things which can go wrong and run into an outage of a data center. Of course, invoicing is very important, especially for colocation sites. So we have an invoicing module, and we have some optimization possibilities like digital twinning and so on. But I will show you the digital twin application a little bit further in my presentation. And of course, if you want to have a complete DCM suite, we're going to deliver some third-party products like Patch Manager, IntelliFi, or others for rack cable, patch management, and IT management. And we do a lot of integration, like to maintenance, to CRM, to ticketing, to invoicing. So we can deliver a complete DCM solution. So that's about our company. So in the year 2018, 2019 and 2020, the Uptime Institute had a global survey sent out to data centers. And there will be a new survey, which will be sent out, I think, somewhere in August, July, August, to data centers. And if you look to the last one, they had 825 respondents, and they asked, okay, what are your biggest worries? What is going wrong? What is going right? How does the future of data centers look like? And those are the key findings are at the right part of my slide. So it's that transparent clouds are good for business. Nowadays, you see that a lot of customers are still afraid of cloud. So what's happening to my data? Where is my data? So make that more transparent is very good. Edge is still on the edge. So it's still not really there, but it's slowly growing. And I think Edge will be unavoidable. To give you an idea, a self-guided vehicle will produce 25 gigabytes of data every hour. And it's you cannot send the data to a central data center or somewhere in the country and then process it and send it back. So you need Edge locations to process data. And that's relevant for all kind of data, of course. What is found very efficient, very interesting, we always talk about the average site efficiency and what we do to improve. But what the Uptime did find out that energy efficiency has flattened the last 7 or 8 years. So this will also be a part of my presentation, but later. Rack density is increasing through time, and that will also influence the resiliency of data centers. And data center staffing is getting increasingly difficult to find. I know in some countries they have some new trainings for data center engineers, data center technicians, and also people who are operating data centers. The outages are becoming more painful within data centers, and more operators admit that outages could have been prevented and were the faults of the operators. And nowadays, problems with power are still the biggest issue for outages. Yeah, this one I find very interesting. If you look to the PUE, I think you all know PUE. It's the total power divided by IT power. If you look to the curve, in 2007, the average PUE was 2.5. In 2013, it's 1.65. And 2019 is 1.67. And now it's 1.59. So actually what you see from 2013 up till today, there hasn't been any real improvement on the PUEs, on the performance of data centers. And so the Uptime Institute tried to find out the reasons, and they have some ideas and some things they know. And what was clear that actually what data centers have been doing to improve the PUE is only actually one thing. It's either cold air or hot air containment. So in 2007 to 2013, all data centers started with containment of hot or cold air. And after that, they don't have any more ideas yet to how to improve. And why did it increase again? Well, the Uptime Institute think it might be caused by global warming, but it can also be caused by movement to the cloud. So when a data center get less dense with their equipment, of course, their efficiency will a little bit decrease. Outages are becoming more disruptive, and what I found also very interesting that between 2019 and 2020, that nowadays 70% of the data centers thought that their outage was preventable. And if you look to the cost of an outage, that's just really hugely increased over the years. So 40% of the outages are having cost between 100,000 and 1 million euros, and even 16% are resulting in a cost of 1 million euro. And in total, about 78% of the respondents who stopped on the list had suffered an outage, and 20% of them had even a very serious outage the last 3 years. And okay, outages, of course, we always talk about it. Sorry, outages.
I will take over this slide. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Sorry.
No worries. You were in a really good flow, Martin, no problem.
This is a
flow. Yeah, no worries. This is very nice. It's a continuation of the story that Martin was talking about in the previous slide. And in this slide, you can see a very interesting screenshot from a website called Down Detector. And it's website with 18 outages in 1 hour on the 17th of June, with some big companies in there, banks and airliners, but also gaming companies. And it just shows you how many outages are actually happening over time. It's a very interesting website to go to maybe after the session. And on the right top here, you can see some headline related to an Amazon data center in Frankfurt that had downtime, which was causing quite some disruption, as they are serving many companies, services for many companies, which are running products from Amazon. And on the bottom side, there are like two really nice screenshots. Those are snapshots taken from the United Airline Company and Bank of America, with two completely different issues. On the left, for United, peak moment where a lot of services were down, causing a lot of issues, customers not being able to check in or order plane tickets, websites that were down in certain areas. But also, the bank, you can see a whole different kind of issue where over time you see that there's always some outage is going on related to different services and different moments. If you can go to the next slide. So when we talk about improving your maturity levels, we also need to understand what our challenges will be for data centers in 2025. As we all know, looking at the top part of this triangle, it's harder and harder to get the right people and the right amount of people in place to support the data center processes and to keep the infrastructure up to speed and on the right levels. And we have to maybe also look at how we can tackle that by going to our educational service providers that can actually maybe tailor some courses and trainings to allow people to get a better understanding of how these things operate. And when you look at the technology side of things, we are constantly growing. The infrastructure is growing. There's more and more data centers coming. So how do we manage capacity, and what are we going to do with automation to tackle a couple of problems in certain areas? And grid capacity, which is a common problem here in the Netherlands, where some areas cannot grow further because there's no grid capacity available at a certain time. So, and the edge locations that are popping up all over the place, those need infrastructure as well from the outside world. And when you look at the processes, we are looking at problems or challenges, let's say, related to regulations, where more and more the governments are getting involved in how data centers are reporting performance and how they're dealing with outages, because they are more and more important for a country's infrastructure. Yeah. Can you go to the next slide? So what are our predictions for 2025? So we all noticed during COVID there's a huge demand now for being able to do your work from wherever you are, and we also believe that for managing data centers, more and more remote management and maintenance will be possible. And will also be mainstream for data centers. It's definitely worth exploring these kind of possibilities, keeping in mind, of course, the security challenges that need to be managed. And we also believe that the digital transformation in certain other domains, for example, the IT domain, where you're looking at the customers or your own IT infrastructure, is changing. Automation will kick in, and IT optimization. So we are looking at IT that is moving places, upscaling and downscaling automatically, as it already works for one of the bigger cloud providers. And also in customers will be able to utilize this technology. But that will also come for data centers. Self-optimizing facilities already a topic being discussed. Data centers, oh, sorry. Data centers will definitely need the technology and equipment to handle much higher temperatures in the data center, as IT equipment will be able to handle higher temperatures. We're talking here about how we're going to push and utilize technology to provide power and cooling to those IT infrastructure. And renewable energy is already being explored and used in some areas, but we don't definitely believe that this is a mainstream technology. And we also believe that due to the ongoing discussion on how the power consumption of a data center is impacting the environment, that also data center customers, let's say, will become more aware of how they are impacting this and how they can save on energy, but also on costs, and how data centers can reduce their carbon footprint. Can you go to the next slide? So when we're looking at this slide, we are looking at a sort of a maturity process where we are constantly growing in how we are operating the data center domain. And when you are looking at the first pillar, let's say, of increased reliability, we are looking at how we can improve the connectivity, the floor space capacity, and reduce the outages and, you know, properly manage power and cooling so that it's more or less on the right track of efficiency. And then when you are there, we can go towards the next topics of, you know, performance improvements based on data that is being presented to you using the right tools that will help you to make the proper decisions to optimize. And then also moving towards automation. So you can, you know, start processes remotely and make the right decisions in more of an automated process description, where we can more and more start to run your data center autonomously. And then we have to support new business models for data centers. There's multiple ways of providing data center services, and this you'll be able to do when you are mastering the previous topics, and based on that also you can, you know, there's sort of a parallels here where you can, using the right data, knowing what to do, you can reduce your carbon footprints, and you can also, using that data, you know, easier adjust to the strict regulations that we believe are coming, since data centers are more and more impacting the environment. If you can move to the next slide. So increasing the data center reliability is the next step of this discussion, where we are looking at how can we make changes to provide better services. And one of the key reasons we find that their outages are made, for example, already told by Martin, was human mistakes. There's lots of human mistakes made because they don't have the right information available to make the right decisions, or where procedures are incomplete or not followed correctly. But also capacity that's not really properly managed in all of the areas where you are operating. And the data that we are looking at, oh, sorry. And the data we are looking at is sometimes not always validated. So when you're looking at data of a month old, that can already be a reason why you're making incorrect decisions to switch something off or to change set points or cooling areas, etc. And UPS problems, something we will discuss a little bit further on, is one of the key reasons as well, where you will have downtime in the area of power. And cooling issues are also some of the main, I think the second biggest reason why there can be outages in a data center causing reliability issues. And then we are looking to three smart ways to prevent outages, which are the pillars we, let's say, pillars to start tackling these problems are to integrate your data sources, make sure that there's information available from all areas and put them together so you have a full view of the information, what impacts each other sometimes in some areas. I think we will discuss that a little bit further on as well. And you need to make sure that the data you're looking at the right stage is accurate. So you need to have some processes in place to tackle that. And the last smart way to prevent an outage is to ensure that there is a redundancy and to monitor on it. So redundancy can be ensured. So you have to plan changes accordingly so that you can always guarantee redundancy in all areas of power and cooling. Next slide, please. So what we're looking at is the starting point of your data center. It's a very simple view of where you have a couple of racks in place, and this is like your first build. So there's a very clear understanding of how the infrastructure is built. People have documentation that's always set up at the beginning of a new data center built or an area. And it's a very simple configuration with some power connected to some breakers and connected to the PDUs and UPSs, etc. But this is the ideal moment where you know how your infrastructure looks like. But when you go to the next slide, after already a couple of days, you will see that there is there's changes starting to happen in your data center where documentation needs to be updated and the complexity is increased here, making it harder to understand what impact some things will have on the infrastructure, but also on moments where you are testing your infrastructure on redundancy, for example. And this will make it also harder to manage your capacity over time. Yeah. And if you can go to the next slide, you will see that on the left side is a very good example. I've seen it many times also in my data center career. You'll see that the IT equipment connected to your power infrastructure is not always connected correctly. So you will see the first few servers on top either have only one power connection or two power connections, but from the same power strip. So there's no redundancy in place, and there's more chances of issues impacting the services that are running in your data center. I think there's only one server on this picture connected correctly, and this will lead to problems serving those services in your data center. But also, as you can see, there's a lot more power consumption on 1.1 feed on the left side, 14.4, on the right only 2.7, and there's imbalance in your power network, in your power infrastructure. And on the right side here, you can see, a screenshot of our DCIM where you can see some problem areas where you see the red color, there's a power consumption going on, but we have no clue where that is happening. So who is doing that? You are starting to become a little bit blind sometimes in your data center, and ensuring having the right tools and the right processes in place, you will be able to start processes to investigate what's happening that is not normal. So the abnormalities in your data center can be investigated if you have the right tools in place to spot these kind of issues. If you can go to the next slide for me. And here you can see a good example of all that information coming together. You've got your floor plan and your rack views, and you see your consumptions on the racks. And if you dig in further, you will see the power balance within the rack and the issues maybe that are related to power, knowing where your power is connected to. On the right, you see a perfect example where you can see how power is connected to a rack power outlet. And having this information documented will make it incredibly easy to analyze impact, to see what will happen if you are going into a maintenance mode or a black site test or any of these kind of moments where it might be possible that services are impacted. And you also understand who to contact in such a case, having all the information stored in one solution. If you can go to the next slide for me, then here we have a good slide showing what we can do to improve power efficiency in your data center. I scrolled a little bit too far. So we're looking at the PUE. As Martin already mentioned in the beginning, the PUE trend is stagnating. Sometimes there's one moment where it has increased, and we are wondering, should this be the right metric to monitor the performance of your data center, or should we consider other metrics as well? And we need to investigate what can be done to properly monitor and manage it. And knowing the PUE better, what does it bring you, and how can we improve it, or how can we utilize it together with some other metrics to make the right decisions to bring that PUE further down, or your data center performance in general, so it's running efficiently with as minimal cost as possible. And those are really, really interesting questions that we want to talk a little bit further about. And I want to pass it back to Martin.
Okay, thank you very much. So now I'm a data center manager, and this is my data center. And my boss comes to me and said, Martin, we have now a PUE. And to be honest, it's a PUE of 1.46, and it should be improved. I like a PUE below 1.4. Okay, looking at this, I see I have some loss on my transformer. I have some loss on my UPSs. And so I wonder myself, okay, now I know my PUE, but how can I improve this PUE? Because I really have no idea. I suppose I should do something with cooling, or because I think that the transformer losses are given, UPS, or what can I do about it? No idea. So actually, what should be the next step? So the green grid did write the PUE partition. And then what they do is they calculated for each part a PUE. So now looking at this figures, so they tell me at room one, I have a PUE. It's a room one of 1.25, room two, it's 1.62. And then I have some general losses, still the same PUE. So I have some clues that looking at these figures, room two, I should do something about room two. But what can I do to improve my PUE? Because still I have no ideas what steps to be taken, and that's also the reason I actually don't like the PUE. The PUE is like your mirror in your car. When you're driving, you're gonna look in your mirror in your car and you see where you've been, but you have no idea where you're going to. And the same is for me. It's true for PUE. I know it was 1.62. I have no 1.22. to 5 or 1.46, I have no idea why it's that value, and I have no idea how to improve it. So something to consider is to take a totally different approach. So of course, you can still use the PUE, but maybe you should combine all the information into some kind of balance scorecard. So from the same data center, I made a balance scorecard. So again, you can see your PUE. It's a general PUE. It's room one, it's room two. So the total PUE is 1.46. Okay, looking to my cooling part of my room one and room two, I can see that my room one has an EER of 4 and room two on 1.6. So I know that my cooling at room two is not efficient at all. And I see something else. I see that looking to my capacity part, I see that my room one has an 83% of loads, room two has only 38. So just by moving some of my capacity, that will already improve not only my capacity division, but also will improve my ER. And there's something else I notice is that my capacity on my UPS is still quite low. And maybe I should also increase that. So bringing that information more in relation to each other, but and also adding the SLAs to it will give me some more tools to really optimize my data center. So now I know I have to move preferably IT from room one to room two. I have to increase my battery load, and that will also increase my PUE and will increase my or decrease my PUE actually, and increase my EER. Well, okay. Improvement is also always a good question, but if you improve, so what are the actual criteria? So looking at this picture, so I like to drive from one city to another, and I want to have the best route. But what is the best route? Is the best route the fastest route? Or is it maybe the cheapest route, or is it the most relaxing route? So if you want to improve, you also have to know on which criteria you want to improve. Looking to your power efficiency, I did show you in the beginning in the balance scorecard that my load on my UPS is quite low. And looking at this figure, you can easily improve your UPS efficiency if you increase your load. But you can also turn it the other way around. So if you decrease your UPS capacity, that will save you two things. It will save you a capex because you don't have to invest in those batteries, and will also improve your opex because if your load on your UPS becomes higher and higher and higher, your efficiency will increase. So it can increase with easily 5% if you just have the right load on your UPS. Okay, this was the text belonging to that. And then, okay, then if you want to improve your performance on cooling, there are several actions to be taken. So the actions can be, I can increase or decrease my pressure differential on my floor below and all under the floor. Maybe I could do something with my inlet temperature, or I can do something with my return temperature. Maybe I can change my redundancy, N plus one, N plus two, N plus three, 2M. Maybe I can do something with my tile setup, maybe open some tiles, close some tiles, or increase air speed, decrease air speed, use higher water temperatures, low water temperatures, move IT, less cracks, more cracks. So there are many things I can do to play with my white space to improve it. But really, what are the results of all those actions? Will they result into hotspots? Will they be will the resiliency go down? Will it really save energy? So I need some toolings to tell me more about the result of those different variations. And I think as a human, it's very complex to understand, okay, I'm going to decrease my pressure differential from 15 Pascal to 10 Pascal. What will it do on my white space area? What will it do on my hotspots? And what will it do on my power usage? So we need some more intelligence. So maybe we can use some artificial intelligence. Looking to the artificial intelligence part, there are several types of AI machines. So looking at the old way, it's called machine learning. And what's the idea of machine learning? Machine learning, you just offer an awful lot of data, and within the data, he's going to find the relations between flow and temperature and power consumption, and so he's going to learn by input what the model is of your data center. So after a while, it has learned quite a lot, and then it can more or less predict what will be happening if something changes. And the other technique is deep learning. Deep learning is more or less the same, but it's a little bit more advanced way of machine learning. So it's more like the neural networking part. But the disadvantage of those two types of learning, they will only know what they have seen. So suppose you're gonna add a new rec to your white space area. It's new for both machine learning and deep learning, and they have to start all over learning again. Or maybe if your crack unit has an outage, it hasn't seen it before, so it has to learn what will be the result of of that falling of that out of the crack, or if your load increases above a level he's ever seen, again he has to learn. So the disadvantage of machine learning and deep learning is that they cannot predict outside the knowledge area. The new way of is called digital twinning, and within digital twinning, it's we also it's a combination of deep learning and adding physical rule sets to your machine. So it also can calculate what will do if my flow will change, what will calculate if my crack unit will fail, what will calculate if a new rack is added. So it's a combination of your model and a physical rule set. So digital twin is actually a digital copy of the reality. And in that way, it can predict outside the boundaries he has ever seen. So if you're going to add 10 new racks, he can already predict what it will do on your power usage, on your hotspots, on your white space without even seeing it. And then it will, if you install those racks, it will optimize the module with the new data. So we have something like that available. So we call it 4D Cool. The fourth dimension is time, of course. It starts with a CFD module, you know, so the heat and flow map. And we install an awful lot of sensors. And of course, this module, normally, if you're making a CFD module in a data center, that's only relevant for maybe 2 or 3 weeks. And then things will start changing. And the CFD model becomes less and less accurate. But in our case, it's not important because we start with a CFD model as an input. And we use the temperature sensors, flow temperatures, flow sensors, humidity sensors to optimize that module. So that module will be all the time really be very accurate. And of course, it also comes with a physical rule set. And when something changes, it will calculate what will be happening before it even has been implemented. So to give you some ideas, this is one of our customers. They are using this engine. And the nice part about this engine, it will create a data monitoring every hour. So every hour it will create a new CFD model showing you the actual situation. But you can also add what if scenarios. So suppose you have a new customer who's going to rent 20 new racks and has an average load of 2.5 kilowatt in a rack. What will it do? Then you can fill it in. You say, okay, I have 20 new racks. This is my average load. Please create a new CFD based on the future situation. So it can create what if scenarios. So then it will create pictures like this, side view, or this one. You can see here the hotspots after a calculation. A top view and another top view. What are really the benefits of this kind of technology? There are several. There was one customer who had a hotspot, and he did see a hotspot, and he wanted to get rid of that hotspot. So what he would like to do is he would like to increase the cold air going to that particular aisle. And actually, what did the model say? Okay, that's not a good idea, because in that case your hotspot will increase. And even though you're going to bring more cold air to that aisle. And what is the reason? That the airspeed was already too high. And if you increase the air going to that cold aisle, the speed was even increasing, and a part of the server rack was not getting cold air anymore. So we did install this application at several of our customers. We have several customer cases, and one of them was a PUE of 1.331, I think. And our tooling helped him to reduce his energy consumption on cooling with 25%, which was actually quite a lot. And in this case, it had an ROI of only 4 months. And of course, the model told us what to do. And what did we do to achieve it? We adjusted some flow, we adjusted some temperatures, we adjusted some tiles, and we even found an equipment wrongly installed. So there was one particular place in the model that the reality and our prediction was not a one-on-one. So there was a variance in that area. So then we entered that area, and what we did, we find a switch that was installed in the wrong way. So he was blowing the hot air into the cold aisle. So we found also a wrongly installed equipment. Okay, and then there's another idea, and there's some we are I'm from the Netherlands, and there's a lot of discussion about reusing data center heat. And to give you some idea, if you in the Netherlands want to heat a house with gas, you will use 1,340 cubic meter gas per year. But if you use a traditional heat pump, you'll use 5,600 kilowatt hour to do the same. But if you can use hot air coming from a data center, either on 25 or 35 degrees, you can reduce your power consumption on your heat pump with 50%. And the nice part, if you're using that AI engine to predict, you can really optimize your return temperature or increase your return temperature, which makes your heat more valuable. Okay, I think that was our part of the presentation. Are there questions?
Okay, thank you, Jess and Martin. Yes, we actually have a few questions, so let me read those. So question one, how many outages are related to the data center infrastructure? How many outages are related?
Yes, sir, you're gonna pick it up?
Yeah, well, I'll answer that question. It's a good question because we were talking about data center improvement and we saw some statistics about the outages. About 70%, according to Uptime, the report that we have used, about 70% is related to the data center, which is the main cause was power, with 30%-ish, and cooling after that. It also mentions network. It's not very clear if that's physical or related to the configuration of the network, but let's consider that part of the infrastructure here, then it's about 70%.
Okay, thank you for the answer. And yeah, another question, how can tooling help to reduce human resources?
Yes, that's something I find very interesting in data center. So if you look to my background, I used to be active in the process control area, and I started in the process control area at 84. So I'm already quite old. So I remember when I was working for an industrial control supplier, I was visiting a food factory and they were producing mayonnaise and ketchup and so on. And people were standing at the production line, holding buckets, filling buckets with mayonnaise and looking at the buckets and then closing it manually. So I was still young at the time. It was in 89, I think. Yeah, 89, 90. So I said to the manager over there, well, why are you doing that? That's, you can easily automate that. And then the person said to me, no, that's not possible, because people have to see the mayonnaise going into the bucket, and then they can see the consistency and the quality, and that's really, really mandatory to deliver a good product. 10 years later, we did the automation for a competitor of them, and there they had a control room, and really nobody was still working inside the factory, so everything was automated. And looking to data centers, I think it's the same. There are many data centers said, well, if you want to change a setting on a crack temperature, or switch it on or switch it off, somebody has to go into the data hall and standing physical in front of the crack unit and change the temperature or put it on, put it off. And actually, I don't think that's how it should be, because you're using a lot of human resources just for very simple tasks. And there's still the chance of an error, because the reason they want that is because they're afraid of errors. Can easily be avoided by automation. So normally in the process industry nowadays, you can say, okay, the operator can change the temperature set point from 20 to 25, and you can limit that in software that he cannot make a mistake. And then if you, for instance, look to redundancy, you can say, okay, if somebody wants to switch off a crack unit, and then I'm going to lose my N+1, it's not possible, we just force it on. And his managers to override that part to switch off. So It's very easy to improve or prevent errors using software, and that's a very easy way to reduce your human resource capacity, because data center become quite big, and sometimes people have to walk for 15 minutes or 20 minutes just to change a temperature set point on a cracklet. So that will help.
Okay, thank you. That was a very detailed answer. Yeah, and I can see. Oh, there is one more question. That's an interesting one. What is the return of investment, ROE, on your digital twin application?
Yes, well, that answer, of course, depends a little bit on what's your actual PUE, what are you using for cooling methods. But what we found out in also decent, very good, like I said, we did one for a governmental organization in Belgium, and it had 1.32 PUE, and they still saved on power consumption around 10,000 euros per month just for cooling, and they had an ROI of just 3 to 4 months. So it can be very short, but of course, if it's a data center which already very, very efficient, then it will be less. But if you look to the numbers of the Uptime Institute, so they say at the moment the average PUE of a data center is 1.58, I think. Well, I think there's a lot to gain, so you can have an ROI less than a year very easily.
Yeah, what I see is also that if you want to do a proof of concept, it's definitely worth trying. If you have suspicions that there are improvements to be made, you don't have to decide to buy a full-blown solution for that. If you want to prove of concept first, I think that's definitely worth doing. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so I think there are no other questions. So I think we can close the webinar. Not sure if you prepared a slide with your contact details. If not, never mind. I will share the webinar recording, including the contact details. So
yes,
I would
do.
I would like to thank everyone for attending our webinar. And yeah, please feel free to reach out to Martin, Matze, and Josef and Ryan. And you can expect an email from me with the recording. So thank you again, and have a good afternoon, everyone.
Well, thank all for attending, and have a great day. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.